All right, we're back here. I was just doing this earlier on. I've got this new software that broadcasts out to Facebook Live that I was using, and for whatever reason, there appears to have been an error which chopped off the broadcast. So kicking it back into high gear again, we're going to start over here with WordPress salaries and how you can raise yours. So so from the top, that's kind of funny. So. Anyway, so here's the thing. I was going to talk about this before. Like, in fact, this article that I'm getting ready to review here came out on Monday, I believe. I actually got it in the WPMU Dev email newsletter, and the article is about WordPress salaries and you know, advice for WordPress developers and how they can increase their income, how they can, you know, do better with their salary. And it was an interesting article. There's a lot of really interesting information in it with regard to the research of how things are, you know, like how things are going salary-wise in a bunch of different areas with, you know, salaried employees, freelancers, with, you know, all the different ways that you can connect in with different WordPress development jobs, including things like Fiverr and Upwork and Codable and so forth. And so the statistics were really cool, like the research that they did and the information they provided I thought was really interesting. But the part that kind of rubbed me the wrong way or kind of just has been stuck in my head for the whole week was the bottom part where they begin to go through 7 different ideas for how you can raise your salary as a WordPress consultant or freelancer or developer. And that's kind of what I wanted to talk about today, because this is what I would consider to be like the mainstream approach to doing better as a WordPress developer. And this is why I think that the advice that they give is sort of makes the article this circular thing where the advice that they give causes people to WordPress developers to be relatively low budget people to hire. And so so that's what I wanted to talk about. How do you fix that? What do you do to get around it? And how do you make that a better situation for yourself and for your clients? And so just to sort of summarize the top part of the article, you know, I'm going to put a link to it here in the comments here after we talk, but so you can kind of review all the stats yourself, because it's pretty interesting stuff. But the main takeaways from like the top 80% of the article is about the salaries, which is that 91% of WordPress freelancers are charging or making less than $35 an hour. So that's a pretty significant thing, right? That's a pretty statistic that, you know, almost all 91% of folks are making less than $35 an hour with their consulting. And then when you add to that the fact that you can't put together, you know, 40 billable hours in a week as a consultant usually, then that begins to cause a big problem, you know, because how are you supposed to stay in business? How are you supposed to run a business at that level when you're not even able to give yourself the opportunity to do your best work? So that's thing number one. Thing number two was, you know, generally the statement still applies that if you want to give yourself a 30% pay cut, then do like a search for some sort of a technical job and then stick the name WordPress at the end of it. And then whatever the job was, if it's, you know, targeting WordPress, the WordPress community, you give yourself a 30% pay cut. So obviously that stinks too. What can you do about it? How can you fix it? How can you do a better job for yourself and for your clients by changing the way you go about your business? And so that's what we're going to talk about. We're going to go through the 7 things that are mentioned here in the article, and I'll give you my feedback on it, see what you think about that, and then you can decide for yourself what you feel like is more effective. So thing number one is in the article, it says, go ahead and increase your prices. You know, just like right off the bat, the thing to do is increase your rates. And of course that is partially true, but it's kind of an incomplete recommendation, because what you're going to find is you can't just increase your rates. If you go ahead and raise your rates, what you're going to find is you lose the job. You lose the job to people who are willing and able to do the work for less. So you have to do more than just raise the rates. You have to change your marketing. You have to change your offer, like what you're proposing to do. Otherwise, you're going to find that you hit this ceiling, and the ceiling tends to be about $1,000. So, you know, if, for example, you were previously charging $800 for a website and you said, hey, you know what, I'm going to start charging, you know, $2,000 or $3,000 now, and you're doing the same exact thing, then you're going to find that clients are going to sort of have their radars tuned into that, and they're going to say, you know what, that's probably not the best investment. That's probably not the best way for me to move forward. I can probably get the kind of outcome in mind for less, because what they're thinking of is they need couple of pages, maybe a contact form. Doesn't seem like a $3,000 type of a thing. And consequently, if you just raise your prices, you're going to just put yourself out of business, because you can get a 5-page website anywhere. In fact, oftentimes you can even do it for free yourself on Wix or something like that. Or if not there, then why not a cheaper WordPress developer? Or if not that, then why not just go into a job board like Fiverr or Upwork or whatever, and, you know, hire someone there to just help you out for way, way less. And so that's the problem. So you can't just increase your prices. In addition to increasing your prices, you have to change your offer. So that's a really big deal. So thing number two that they recommend is become a specialist. And so I think that's probably on the surface seems like a really good idea also, because usually specializing in a particular thing tends to be a better type of a situation where you get paid more if you're like really good at something. Like think about doctors. Like, you know, if you go into like a heart care specialist, then that tends to be, or like a digestive specialist, then that tends to be like a better, a higher value kind of a thing than just kind of going to a general practice environment to, you know, just figure out what's going on. Same thing for like, you know, a handyman versus somebody who's like awesome at being like an electrician, for example, or whatever. You know, like as you begin to move yourself over towards a specialty, you begin to get really good at that thing, and therefore the rates go up. But here's the thing. So the recommendation was, you know, get really good at WooCommerce or get really good at making membership sites. And, you know, that's sort of true. Like maybe, you know, that makes it a little bit better. But the problem is that those services are, they're almost commodities. Like you can find anybody who's really good at WooCommerce. I mean, you don't really have to specialize in WooCommerce, for example, because anybody can pick it up in just a short period of time. And same thing with building a membership site. You don't have to be like a guru to build a membership site. So that's not really much of a specialization. And so so all of that is to say that, you know, specializing in something is a good idea, but you can't just specialize in something. Again, kind of like the raising the prices thing. Yeah, raising your prices is a good idea, but you can't just raise your prices. You have to do more. And the same thing with the specialization. And so then you begin to think, well, okay, well, instead of specializing my skill set, maybe the idea would be maybe I can specialize like the industry that I want to work with. And so instead of going out and giving your crappy offer to everybody, now you go and give your bad offer to just a segment of people, like folks, for example, instead of just e-commerce at large, now you're really good at doing e-commerce for people that like sell like snorkels or water gear or something. Hey, Rebecca, it's good to see you. High five to you. And so that kind of specialization tends not to be very effective, because instead of having everybody in the world tell you no, now people that sell snorkel equipment tell you no. So everybody, you know, the end result is you still hear no all of the time, because you're not changing the offer, you're not changing the approach, you're not changing the way that you're attracting clients, interacting with clients. And so like a bad offer for one person is going to be a bad offer for another, even if you decide I'm only going to give my bad offer to a certain segment of the industry. So that's why I feel like the concept of specialization, as it's mentioned here, is sort of an incomplete kind of a thing. And that, you know, a better approach would be to make a better offer and then offer that you know, make that offer to the people to whom it applies. So then thing number three is affiliate partnerships. And so I think that's a good idea. You know, affiliate partnerships, there's nothing the matter with that. Like if you're already doing something like this article that I'm reviewing here is from Kinsta. They're like the premium managed WordPress hosting company. I don't really work with them. I've never done any work with them before. But this article was really popular. It got picked up in the WP MU Dev newsletter. And you know, I've noticed that it's gotten a bunch of shares, a bunch of views. It's a really popular article. So I wanted to just kind of give my feedback on it. And I think this is the reason, kind of the main reason why they wrote the article, was to let people know that they have an affiliate program. And so if you refer folks there, then you can, you know, make some additional revenue for yourself by, you know, hosting with them, and good for them too, right? So that sounds like a good deal. Nothing the matter with that. And if you're already doing, like, it could even go beyond hosting. So for example, if you have themes that you're using, you can get a relationship with the creators of the theme to get some sort of an affiliate partnership or whatever may be the case. If you're already referring folks to people, and the people to whom you're referring them have an affiliate program, why not sign up for it, right? And so there's that. So that's a good idea, but that's not a high ticket idea. I mean, you're not going to start making, you know, running a 6-figure WordPress business because suddenly your hosting partner has an affiliate program. But nevertheless, it's not a bad idea, you know, something to consider. And then, so then thing number four was WordPress maintenance. So offer maintenance plans or care packages. And this is something we've talked about a couple of times before about the concept of a WordPress care plan or care package. And so, yeah, totally do it, because you need to have, you know, if you're building a WordPress site, you have to care for it, right? You have to keep it up to date. You have to keep it secure. You have to do backups. You know, all of those things are really important. So go ahead and make sure that you're doing that. But here's the problem. If all you're offering is the care package, in terms of doing the backups and the security and the plugin updates and whatever, if that's the entirety of the offer, everyone's going to say no again. Or if they don't say no, they're only going to be willing to pay a very small amount for that. And also, this is the kind of thing that begins to make your investment a bad investment. Because if you're moving somebody from, say, like a platform like Wix or Squarespace, where you don't have to do that, where you don't pay extra for backups and security and plugin updates and things like that, then, you know, saying, okay, well, let's move your site over to WordPress, and now you can pay me for stuff you didn't have to pay for before, that's a bad, nobody wants to do that. It's a bad thing. And so, now granted, once you move to WordPress, you'll be able to do many more things. You'll have a lot more control over stuff, and you can fine-tune stuff, and you know, there's a lot more stuff that you can do. And anything that comes to mind, even if there's not a plugin for it, you can create one in a really easy way. So there's a huge, huge market and opportunity for moving into WordPress. But most of the time, WordPress developers tend to focus on the downsides and ask for people to pay them to fix that issue in the form of, you know, this WordPress care stuff. And so on top of that, another thing that they recommend, which is not a bad idea, is you can kind of outsource that too. Like, depending on where you host, the host might take a big chunk of that labor away from you, so you don't have to like manually do things. Like manage WP. Hey, Chrissy, manage WP might be another solution, you know, where you can kind of outsource, the technical maintenance of things. Another one would be like iTheme Sync, which I've used for a long time. And, you know, you're able to kind of keep plugins and stuff updated just kind of with the click of a button. It'll do a whole bunch of sites all at once. That really helps speed things up. And so, yeah, so go ahead and do WordPress maintenance plans. But again, that's not going to be the thing that solves the problem. That's not going to bring you a high ticket business. You're not going to be scaling to $5,000 or $10,000 per month because you're offering maintenance plans. Because, I mean, you just can't charge a lot of money for that. And if you are, you're presenting a bad investment to your clients because it's not a very valuable thing. So there's that. So the whole concept of doing the maintenance plans, do it, but do more than that. Again, so the first four things we've talked about increasing your prices, becoming a specialist, doing affiliate partnerships, and now this maintenance thing, all of those things are good ideas on the surface, but they're just kind of incomplete ideas. It doesn't give you the full picture of what you really need to be doing. So then the fifth thing is, find a quality marketplace. So like if you're having a hard time locating clients, the suggestion is instead of going on to Upwork, where the average hourly rate is significantly less than what you want, 91% of folks are making less than $35 an hour. That's basically everybody. So if you instead go to a more specialized marketplace like Codable, then you know they start at $60 an hour. And so you're gonna be guaranteed to make at least $60 an hour on Codable. Now granted, I've never worked through Codable. I'm just saying what it said in the article. And it makes some sense. You're thinking, okay, yeah, specialized marketplace. But you know what? Everyone's gonna go to the, I mean, I haven't even talked to anyone who does a lot of work through Codable yet. It's, you know, why would you go to Codable and pay $60 an hour when you can go into Upwork and pay $20 an hour if the outcome is basically the same? If all you need is a couple pages and a contact form and something simple, you know, that's the thing. Now, if you need like a really custom plugin or something really advanced or something like that, maybe Codable is a better alternative. But what I've found to be the case is very few WordPress developers are going onto Codable and making a living at it. So, and instead, most people don't really do that at all, and instead either try to go to Upwork or, you know, something else, and it tends to be a pretty low-quality thing. But the general idea is, like, if you're going on to a quality marketplace, you'll get paid a higher hourly rate, and that's probably true, but my recommendation is don't go onto a marketplace. Don't do that, because there's too many people there. The competition is out, you know, through the roof, and oftentimes you'll find that you're competing against people that can afford to work for way less than what you would need to keep your business open. Because like oftentimes people are in different countries where they don't have the same expenses and the conversion rate of money and currencies and so forth is very favorable for them, where it's not so much for you. And so it's an uneven playing field. It's really, really hard to stay in business like that. And so rather than that, why not actually work with a handful of clients that you know, like people that you actually know? Maybe they're local to you, maybe not physically local, but maybe you have like a real face-to-face type of relationship in the beginning, and you can start working with those people and offering to do things for them on an ongoing basis, so you don't have to find clients all the time. And that's like a really big idea. So like the main thing that I try to do, that I really try to help people with, is build a business that you can scale to an extra $5,000 to $10,000 per month consistently on your own, with a workload that you can bear on your own without freaking yourself out. And so, like, you know, somewhere between like 5 billable hours per day, you know, at that level, that gives you, you know, 3 hours to do non-billable stuff like taxes and emailing and whatever you need to do, and then 5 hours of billable work. And that's a really nice ratio of time to labor. And you can scale that up to, you know, well over 6 figures on your own. And then if you want to scale beyond that, awesome, do that too. But that gives you a really solid base, so that, you know, the risk is dramatically reduced, the stress is dramatically reduced, and you just have this consistent income coming in. And if that sounds like the kind of thing that you're interested in learning more about, let's talk about that one-on-one, so we can, you know, figure exactly what you need to do to get to where you are, from where you are now to where that is a reality for you. So, but all that is to say, the answer is not to go onto a marketplace to try to establish relationships like that, because the competition is too strong, and you're going to get into this cycle where you just try to find client after client after client after client, and you get into this crazy race where you're not actually able to do your best work, and therefore you're not driving the results you need to be for your clients, and you constantly have to find the next client, so you're racing through your work, and then you never know, like, you have that feast or famine problem where you have too much work and then no work, and you're not scaling at all, because every time you finish a project, your income goes to zero until you get another one, and who knows how long that's going to be. So it's just a mess. And so my recommendation is, don't go into a marketplace at all. And instead, you can do a lot better than that for yourself and for your clients too. So and that's kind of a third thing that I want to say about these marketplaces. Like, if you find, in fact, I'm planning to actually talk more about this later in like a whole session just about this. But like, if you find yourself accepting like requests for proposals, like RFPs, then you're kind of connecting in with the wrong type of client and at the wrong time in the relationship, because you're gonna find that those types of clients, they just want to boss you around and tell you what to do and get work out of you for as cheap as possible, and they're not really looking for any sort of leadership or help or anything. They just want somebody to type the code or whatever. And so that tends to not be a very effective way to go about winning high value clients, especially in the WordPress marketplace. So, you know, all of that is to say that I feel like that going into any marketplace, whether it's Upwork or Codable or whatever, is not where I would recommend folks go to find clients. And instead, actually make an offer that matters and then present it to people that you like and that you want to keep working with on an ongoing basis and that do stuff that matters for their clients. So that's thing number 5. Thing number 6 is work on your communication. And of course, that's an awesome idea. Everyone needs to work. I don't care what job you're in or, you know, what you're trying to do. You know, working on your communication is definitely going to benefit you no matter what. But again, it's an incomplete sort of a thing. Just because you're nicer now, that doesn't mean that you're going to be a high ticket sought after consultant. It just means you're going to write better emails and whatever, you know, you'll be better at communicating. And so, yeah, that's definitely a good thing, but it's not going to get you to the next level. It's like, what they say in the science world, it's like, it's a sufficient, you know, or a necessary but not a sufficient condition. So like, it's necessary to do that, but it's not all you need. And so, you know, working on your communication, being better at communicating, and you know, being more empathetic, that kind of stuff, all of that is a great idea. So, you know, thumbs up on that, but it's not going to get you to the next level. It's just one thing that you need to add to the mix and along the way. And then the last thing is, you know, this seems like kind of scraping the bottom of the barrel, but, you know, taxes, you know, do you know that being self-employed has different tax implications than, you know, being employed by a business or whatever? And, you know, seek out the help of a professional tax accountant to try to mitigate the pain of taxes. And again, that is a great idea. Don't not do that. You know, do well with your taxes. Hey, Stephen. And, you know, definitely do all that good stuff. But on top of it, That's not gonna get you up to the next level. That's just not going. I mean, nobody ever said, "Oh man, you wouldn't believe it. I was just really struggling. I was making like 2 grand, maybe 3 grand a month, And then all of a sudden I said, I found a tax accountant and now Shazam, I'm making six figures. It doesn't, nobody does it like that. That's not, it's an unrealistic expectation that that kind of a change is going to make your, you know, bump you up in any sort of a major or significant way. So, So the reason that I wanted to go through all of those seven things with you guys is because this is the mainstream approach to what people are suggesting that WordPress developers do. And what I'm suggesting is none of those things are going to fix the issue. Not a single one. Even all together, you can do all seven of those things all day long. And, you know, like you said, like increase your prices, you're going to lose your clients unless you have a better offer. Become a specialist, you're just going to keep hearing no, but just more from a specialized group of people unless you make a better offer. And then number three, affiliate partnerships, great, but that's not a high ticket thing. You're not going to make $1 million off of that, you know, working with, you know, 10, 20, even 50 to 100 clients. And then, you know, thing number four, you know, WordPress maintenance. Definitely do WordPress maintenance, but if you're selling WordPress maintenance, you're not going to win clients. In fact, you're probably going to lose them, and if you're, especially if they're coming off of Wix or Squarespace where they didn't have to do the maintenance in the first place. So so that's thing number four. Thing number five, you know, find a marketplace. Don't find a marketplace. In fact, I would suggest avoid marketplaces at all costs and instead, you know, seek out people that you can actually help. And the marketplace thing is just a mess. In fact, I'm going to probably do a whole nother session specifically on why marketplaces like Codable and Upwork are a big mess for the kinds of WordPress developers that we all are. So, number six, you know, communication, definitely work on your communication, but again, it's not going to bump up your salary that much. And then find a tax accountant. I thought that was a good one, but you know, I'm sorry. That's just not going to win you more clients. So what will win you more clients is actually making a better offer for people you want to work with and, you know, and solving problems for their business. And that's the key. So if you want to figure out how to implement that into your business so you don't have to burn yourself out with these low budget, high stress clients all the time that just want you to work harder and, you know, for cheaper until you give up. And literally, I mean, I can't tell you how many people I've talked to that, you know, they say, man, Lee, you know, I've got the, it's not that I can't find leads, but they just want me to work for cheap. And, you know, and when I finally just say yes, because I need the job, and then I start working, and the cheaper the project is, the harder they want me to work. And everybody's so nitpicky all the time. And I tell you what, I just want to quit. I just want to quit. And then, of course, we talk about it more, and I say, is it that you don't like building websites? Is it that you don't like working with, why do you want to quit? And they want to quit because they're being treated like trash. It's not, they don't want to quit because they don't love the work. They don't want to quit because they don't love helping businesses, you know, get leads and, you know, grow their businesses. They love all that stuff. That's the stuff that really fires people up. They love and are excited about that, but they can't do it because the clients that they're working with and the clients that they're attracting aren't the right clients, and they're not presenting their offers in the right way to actually engage their clients in a way that's actually going to allow them the opportunity to do their best work and the opportunity to lead their clients into a degree of success that is outside of their current scope. The problem that most clients have is they don't know how to get the success. And then when they go to Upwork and put a request for proposal out there, the request is a crappy request because they don't know what to do. And then, of course, the people on Upwork, they just do their best job. They do a good job doing the work, but the outcome is still going to be crappy because the request was crappy. And so all of that is to say that if you really want to get into a high-ticket environment where you're actually onboarding clients that make a difference to your business so that you can make a difference to their business, then I think what you'll find is, you know, you're going to have a good offer. You're going to have to find clients that you know and like and want to continue working with on an ongoing basis. And you're going to have to present something that solves a business problem. You're going to have to present a solution to their issues. So there's a lot of stuff that can go into figuring out how to do that. And so let's talk about how to pull that off. And it really it matters a lot who you're going to be working with. Like, for example, if you're working with a landscaper, that looks different from if you're working with like a health coach, which looks different from a personal trainer, which is different from a restaurant. You know, all of the different industries have different kinds of goals. So let's talk about who it is that you like to work with. And like, for example, I like to work with functional medicine doctors. They're the kind of doctors that kind of dig in deep to the root causes of your problems and then give you relatively natural solutions for them. you know, to try to, you know, get people off of habitual, ongoing, you know, like medications, if you can do that safely, of course, and into a more healthy lifestyle. And then you'll get, and then it solves all kinds of issues, knee problems, back problems, digestive problems, headaches and migraines. And it's like, it's very exciting for me to be able to be part of that kind of experience. And so I like working with people like that. And that might apply to you too. Or you might say, hey, you know what? I love working with yoga studios, or I love working with, you know, fill in the blank, like whatever it is that you're interested in and you like. The idea here is avoid the marketplaces where just any old person shows up, and be intentional about seeking out who you want to work with, and then make some offers that make a difference for them. So that's what we should talk about. So if that sounds like you, and you actually want to make more money for yourself as a WordPress consultant, and you know, you want to get, you know, $5,000 to $10,000 per month coming in consistently, so that you don't have to chase clients all the time, let's talk about how to do that. So if that sounds good to you, it definitely sounds good to me. And we can hook up one-on-one at doublestack.net/call. That's where you'll find my calendar. Pick a time that works for you. We'll get on the phone like for 45 minutes for free. And we'll start, you know, walking down this path of how can you get from where you are now into this solution where you're actually working with the clients you want at the prices you're really worth. So doublestack.net/call, and we'll get that going. So awesome, guys. Sorry for the little glitch in the beginning where, for whatever reason, that little broadcasting app I was using kind of crashed on us, you know, 10 minutes into it. But again, it's great to see you guys here. And thanks for all the high fives. And if you have any questions or want to talk about this kind of in this group, let's do that. You feel free to write a comment there. I'm going to put a link to this Kinsta article, so you can check out the different stats for the different salaries and so forth, because it's really interesting. But the really eye-opening thing is, you know, WordPress developers are really struggling out there. And if you want to get to that $5,000 to $10,000 per month, so that you've got a business that you're proud of, that you love working at, where you wake up in the morning and you're energized, and you want to get away from all of these low-budget, high-stress, nitpicky clients that just want to work you to you feel like you want to quit, then, you know, you can absolutely make that transformation. And we can talk about it at doublestack.net/call. Sounds good. And so here is a high five, kaboom, for the weekend. And you know what? Next week is going to be Thanksgiving. And so we're definitely not going to be doing a training session on Thanksgiving Day, which will be next Thursday. And so we might all just have one on Tuesday for next week. So awesome, guys. It was great talking to you. And I really look forward to connecting up again, either on the phone or next Tuesday or here in the comments. And so thanks for showing up. And we'll be back in touch again soon. All right, guys. Awesome. Take care.